Hello, New Hope. It's Pastor Jeff. Hope that you're off to a great start of your week. I'm really excited to be able to bring today's daily devotional to you. I'm not sure if you're aware, but on our Facebook page, we post every day a daily meditation. There's a verse of the week, and the verse for this week is John 16:33, where Jesus said, "In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for I've overcome the world." The daily devotional verse for yesterday was found in 2 Timothy 3:12, where it says, "Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." There are a lot of people who have the misconception that as Christians, all of our problems will be solved. Or if you're going through a trial, there must be something wrong with you. You see, that isn't quite true, because what God says is expect trials. It's not a matter of if, but when. In this world, you will have trouble. Acts 14:22 says that we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of heaven. You see, God uses adversity to transform us. Why is that? It's because adversity has a way of molding and shaping and strengthening us, making us more and more the kind of person that God wants us to be. We often long for days without difficulty, but God knows better. He knows that the easier our life, the weaker our spiritual fiber. Strength of any kind grows only through exertion. By trials, James is talking about a divinely ordained difficulty that God either causes or allows in order to chip away at our imperfections and flaws in order to make us more like Jesus. God's purpose for us, according to Romans 8:29, is to transform us and to conform us into the image and likeness of his son, Jesus. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, "All of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image." We need to understand that if that is his purpose for us, then he will not be satisfied until that happens. And he will use any means necessary to bring that about, including allowing or sending whatever it takes until we respond to him and allow him to make the inner changes needed for us to become like his son. What is our part in making sure that the adversity that God allows or sends our way does what it intends to do, which is developing us spiritually? Well, there are three things: a joyful attitude, an understanding mind, and a surrendered will. James says to consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. It's a matter of faith, a matter of taking what we don't understand, which is our pain, and looking at it through the spiritual lens. God's incredible love for us and his desire to transform us and make us more like Jesus. Paul uses this word consider several times in Philippians 3. When he became a Christian, things that were once important to him became worthless in the light of his experience with Christ. He said, "But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ." He also says, "I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ." To consider means to evaluate. You see, our values determine our evaluations. Our outlook determines our outcome, and our attitude determines our action. So do you value comfort more than character? Do you value material and physical more than spiritual? Do you live for the present and forget the future? If so, then you're not going to be able to consider it joy. Those things are going to upset you and make you bitter, not better. When we face trials of life, we must evaluate them in the light of what God is doing for us. You see, he wants us to see the purpose behind the pain, to test our faith, to build our perseverance and our maturity, to transform us into the image of him. 2 Corinthians 4:16 to 18 says, "Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Jesus is a perfect example for considering the joy in the midst of the pain. Hebrews 12:2 says, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." Next, we have an understanding mind. James says, "Consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance." A person who hasn't placed their faith in God will almost always have a difficult time making sense of all that happens in life. We often do as Christians. There's not one of us who has never gotten to a point in their life where we wonder, "Why me?" Or, "What have I done to deserve this?" Or we even just thought, "This just isn't fair." But it's not supposed to be that way for us who are believers, who have placed our faith in Jesus Christ. Though in the midst of our sufferings and trials, we may not know what God has in mind, we can say like James, I know that the testing of my faith produces perseverance. In other words, trust God enough to know that He knows what He is doing in everything. The third thing is a surrendered will. If you've ever taken tests in school, you know that it's one thing to tell your instructor, your teacher, that you know the material that he or she has been teaching. But it's another thing altogether to be able to prove that you know it by taking and passing a test. Likewise, saying that you trust God and you're willing to follow His leading no matter where He tells you to go or what He tells you to do is very different from actually doing it. A good teacher won't take our word for it when it comes to passing a test, and neither will God. That's why God allows and even causes those times of testing, why He allows our faith to be put through the fire of adversity. James tells us that it's important to understand that God has a purpose for our suffering and that we need to be willing to allow that purpose to take its course. He says in verse 4, let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Many Christians try to shelter themselves from trials and as a result never grow up. Through the physical conflict, God wants to draw your attention to the spiritual. And when you go through a trial, it's important for you to look for the spiritual lesson that God is trying to teach you. You can't look at a financial difficulty as simply a financial difficulty and nothing more. It's vital that we change our focus from the pain itself to God's purpose for it. Trials are inevitable in this life. But you can be sure that what some might mean to harm you, God will use it for good. Romans 8:28 says, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him and are called according to His purpose for them. James concludes this kind of section with this verse in verse 12, where he says, God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Afterward, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love Him. We're going to face difficulties. We're going to face trials. But God has a purpose. God has a plan. Let's look to Him. Let's consider Jesus. Let's endure, knowing that He is going to give us what we need and get us through it. Let me pray for you. God, we thank You. And as James says, we consider it joy when we face trials, when we face difficulties. And we are facing difficult times. We live in difficult days. But we know, God, that You were faithful to work in us, to work through us, to bring Your purposes forth in our life. So we look to You, we trust You, we consider all that You went through for us, and know that, God, if we can suffer with You and suffer for You, You are working it all together for our good. And we thank You for that. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day.